Today we celebrate the sixth Sunday of our Pentecost season. Our service begins on page 355 in the Book of Common Prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Like the mourning of an only son, it like a bitter day. The time is surely coming, says the Lord God, and I will send famine on all the land, not a famine of bread or a thirst of water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. They shall wander from sea to sea, from the north to the east. They shall run to and fro, seeking the word of the Lord, but they shall not find it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join with me in reading Psalm 52, together, found in your service bulletin. Together.
You tired, why do you boast of wickedness against the godly all day long? You plot ruin, your tongue is like a sharpened razor, O Lord, worker of deception. You love evil more than good, and lying more than speaking the truth. You love all words that hurt, O you deceitful tongue. O that God would demolish you utterly, topple you and snatch you from your dwelling, and root you out of the land of the living. The righteous shall see and tremble, and they shall laugh at him, saying, this is the one who did not take God for a refuge, but trusted in great wealth and relied upon wickedness. But I am like a green olive tree in the house of God. I trust in the mercy of God forever and ever. I will give you thanks for what you have done, and declare your goodness to remain in the presence of the godly.
A reading of the letter, from the letter Paul to the Colossians. Jesus is the image of an invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. In him all things in heaven and earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was pleased to reconcile to himself all things, whether on heaven or on earth, by making peace through the blood of his cross. And you who were once estranged and hostile in mind, doing evil deeds, he has now reconciled in his fleshy body through death, so as to present you holy and blameless, irreproachable before him, provided that you continue securely established and steadfast in the faith without shifting from hope promised by the gospel that you heard, which has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven. I, Paul, became a servant of this gospel. I am now rejoicing in my sufferings for your sake, and in my flesh, I am completing what is lacking in Christian's afflictions for the sake of his body, that is, the church. I became its servant according to God's commission that was given to me for you, to make the word of God fully known. The mystery has been hidden through the ages and generations, but now has been revealed to his saints. To them, God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. It is he whom we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone in all wisdom, so that we may present everyone mature in Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke. As Jesus and his disciples went on their way, Jesus entered a village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks. So she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." The Gospel. Tyranny of the urgent. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Please be seated. In our later years, Edie and I did not entertain as much as we used to, but when we did, it was usually a last-minute event and things got a little crazy around our house. Before our guests would arrive, I am a man on a mission. Sometimes it felt like the intensity of Mission Impossible. Help clean up the house, plan the dinner, find just the right recipes, go shopping, and then start all the preparations for dinner. By the time our guests arrived, I am frantically trying to multitask at several stations in the kitchen, along with pacing back and forth in and outside of the grill. As many of you know, it's an unforgiving balancing act to do all of that. By the time I fix everyone something to drink and appetizers are served, then I need to return to my counter work. Shortly, there are no appetizers left to try, and my drink has turned to water. I would look over at Edie, and she's smiling and laughing and is deeply engaged in conversation with our friends. She was actually a wonderful social hostess. But at the end of what was usually a successful evening, our guests would sometimes comment that next time they'd like to spend a little bit more time with me. And then after the front door would close, Edie would concur that I spent entirely too much time in the kitchen. Well, Martha, honey, I feel your pain. Does that sound familiar to some of you? In our gospel reading today, Jesus challenges Martha on spending too much time in the kitchen while defending Mary for being a listening disciple. Now, it's important to note that Jesus' reaction in the context of his ministry. It was crunch time in Jesus' ministry. Luke says earlier that his face was set toward Jerusalem. Jesus was on the final roads that would lead him to his suffering, his death, and his resurrection. Jesus must have been keenly aware of what was really important in life, especially during that time. What was important to Jesus during that time? Well, apparently, the relationships with his friends and the importance of the word. Jesus is not getting on Martha's case for preparing him a meal or showing hospitality to him and the other disciples. In fact, Jesus was known for enjoying a good meal and good hospitality. The task of hospitality and showing hospitality was a long-standing virtue in this culture, and still is today. There were even laws about such things in ancient Israel. Hospitality was very important to the early church. So what point was Jesus making here? Well, Jesus is not attacking the practical matters and roles of this life, but the preoccupations with them. As one of my seminary professors would say, matter matters in the kingdom of God. God didn't just write a love note in the clouds to us. I love you. He sent his son to be incarnate in the flesh to tell us about his love for us. The greatest love message, love card that we could have ever received. Much of the kingdom of God is found in the messy details of everyday life. In our gospel reading today, it says that Martha was distracted by her many tasks. And later Jesus says, "Martha, Martha," reminiscent of "Abraham, Abraham, Terry, Terry, you are worried and distracted by many things." The Greek translation of the word distracted means literally to be pulled from all directions. The Greek translation for worried means to be anxious, to be troubled or distressed. Jesus is actually addressing an eternal state of mind, not just the action, a state of mind. Jesus is not challenging Martha because of her service, but warns her about living in a world where many things can take on a weight of urgency. Jesus is talking about the tyranny of the urgent. Being consumed by what seems to be urgent. Anxiety, distress, conflict and preoccupations come from the tyranny of the urgent. They are distractions from what Paul Tillich, that great theologian, would call our ultimate concern. A distraction from our ultimate concern. And the ultimate concern is listening to God. Martha was so anxious about doing that she had trouble hearing and being present to the Word of God. Jesus does not say that Martha should stop caring about hospitality or the many other things of her life. He is, though, concerned that she not become so anxious about the things to the point of distraction. A distraction from the ultimate concern, listening to God and being present. Like himself, he wants Martha to be a non-anxious presence, both non-anxious and present. The key issue in this story easily translates to our present time, doesn't it? Perhaps more than ever before, we live under the oppression of the tyranny of the urgent. The stress, the anxiety, the distractions of doing are all too well known to most of us. Many of us are perhaps overfunctioning. Our overfunctioning inhibits our ability to sit with God and listen. It inhibits our spiritual growth. Jesus is saying to Martha, and he's saying to us, there's a time to go and do, and there's a time to sit and listen. The Samaritan in the Good Samaritan Gospel that we just talked about, and Mary, the Good Samaritan and Mary, a woman who bends the gender roles by being a disciple at Jesus' feet. They are both very unlikely heroes. A Samaritan, a woman with all the boys at Jesus' feet? Some theologians believe that a part of Martha's criticism of Mary was her discomfort with this liberating role of Mary, who was there with Jesus and the other disciples. A woman. Jesus treating a female as a disciple. This may be true since Jesus has all about stretching those boundaries in the kingdom of God. And we've been talking about some of the kingdom of God parables where Jesus brings about rather a radical change. But Jesus is also trying to, think about this, Jesus is also trying to liberate Martha from the burden of obsessive duties and distractions. Jesus wasn't trying to punish Martha. He was trying to free her up. Free her up so she could also be included with equal footing and to also sit and listen. He wasn't trying to condemn Martha as much as he was trying to free her up from the tyranny of the urgent and cultural expectations. You know, many priests fall into the trap of over-functioning in maintaining the details of the congregational life, and there are many, while sometimes falling short of listening to or just being present to God. Okay, guilty. Church members can become so preoccupied with all the busyness of the organization or programs or even ministries that they are distracted from the real business and mission of the church. Hearing the word of God and living out the gospel. It is through the word of Christ that lives are renewed and the church is truly built. So let us pray that we will all join Mary at the feet of Jesus, men and women, that we will balance and prioritize. And that's really the theme of today's sermon or scripture, is prioritizing. That we will balance and prioritize our doing so that we may sit at the feet of Jesus and hear the words that will change our lives and the lives of others. May it be so with us here today. Let's now stand and say together the Nicene Creed. The Nicene Creed is the outline of our Christian faith, found on page 358 in the Book of Common Prayer. Together, we believe in one God, the Father and Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people, Form 3, are found in your service bulletin. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
Remembering especially Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Pope Francis of the Roman Church, Michael, our presiding bishop, the bishops and ministers of the Episcopal Church and the Anglican community, Phoebe, our bishop, and Father Terry, our priest, we pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
Remembering especially Joe, our president, Bill, our governor, and all mayors of Shelby County and the surrounding areas, we pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
Remembering especially Elena, Alton, Jim, Jane, Lynn Lee, Jessica, Carolyn, Rusty, Larry, Elizabeth, Sonia, the Weatherly family, Jason, and Holly. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest, especially Betsy McGinnis.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into the kingdom of joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
In the Diocesan Circle of Prayer, we pray for Emmanuel Ripley. We pray for the West Tennessee Haiti Partnership Mission. We pray for the Village Mission in Liberia, Africa. We pray for peace of Jerusalem. We pray for peace among all nations. We pray for peace for our own nation. We pray for the protection and comfort of all of those who serve this country in foreign and domestic lands, especially Trevor Hawley, Rachel Miller, and Jacob Stevens. Christians that are being persecuted throughout the world. The altar flowers are given to the glory of God by Jennifer Temple in honor of Greg's birthday. Let us pray for members of our parish family celebrating a birthday, especially Jack Stevens, Greg Temple, Donna Turner, Paula Maslowski, and Frank O'Donnell. Let us pray for all members of our parish family celebrating an anniversary this week, especially Randy and Latrice Boren. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
Pray for those suffering from the heat and drought, especially the poor, the homeless, the elderly, and our farmers, nationally and locally. Bless us with cooler temperatures and rain.
Amen.
Let us pray for Sherry Peoples in Weatherford, Texas, undergoing emergency surgery.
Pray for Susan Jones, currently in ill health and beginning her treatments for cancer.
We pray for the men's breakfast crew to serve a wonderful breakfast.
We continue to pray for the country of Ukraine. We also give thanks for all the blessings in this life. Amen.
Amen.
O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Let us now confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Our confession can be found on page 360 in the Book of Common Prayer. Together, most mercifully God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name.
Amen. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Forgive you all of your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you into eternal life.
Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Also with you.
Peace, everyone. Peace. So good to see you all. Peace.
Peace, Margaret.
Peace, Mary.
Good morning.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
blessing us. Thank you.
Thanks, Pam, for taking care of me and bringing her here.
It gets to be a family affair, doesn't it?
Yes, it does.
Okay. Well, with two Marthas in the house, y'all must be a mess.
We are.
Speaking of which, so I don't feel so alone, do we have any Marthas in the house? Do we just happen to have any Marthas in the house? Okay. You know what? Some of you didn't raise your hands, and I know better. I love that scripture, and frankly, that sermon, even though it's a big ouch, a lot of people read that scripture and they don't understand it. You know, they think, oh gosh, you know, if Martha wasn't doing everything, then things wouldn't get done. You know, poor Martha, Jesus is fussing at Martha. But it's much more than that, as the teaching unfolded today. It was about freeing Martha up. You know, the bottom line is, somebody's got to do that stuff, right? We just have to put it in perspective. A couple of announcements we have this morning. We want to welcome our guests and our visitors. We're so glad that you all are here with us today, helping us celebrate this service. Thank you for that. We hope that you might pick up what we call one of our little goodie bags, and that tells you a little bit more about who we are, and also that you might fill out a visitor's card just to let us know how we might further help you. Well, our men's club breakfast continue today and will continue the next couple of Sundays at least. Please come and join us. For the 10:30 folks, that means come a little bit early. Have a cup of coffee with your 8 o'clock members, with your 8 o'clock family, and have breakfast with us if you would like. But even if you just come by and have a cup of coffee, we would love to see you. Let's continue to keep in our thoughts and our pocketbooks our primary outreach ministries right now, and that is our Thistle and Bee ministry, the prescription bottle ministry, and the ever-in-need food bank ministry. Please give generously to those. Are there any other announcements that we might have?
Yes. The Episcopal Layman's Conference is coming up the 19th of August to the 21st. I'm going to keep hounding you until I get some more guys to go because, guys, it is really, really, really worth it. And the speakers are, you know, inspiring, and the food is good. And you have a lot of fellowship with some of your fellow Episcopalians across the state of Tennessee.
Yes.
The service on Sunday is at the Somani Chapel. Is it a chapel?
Chapel. It's called a chapel, but it's a cathedral.
It's a cathedral. it's absolutely beautiful. It's like you would imagine a cathedral to be, big stone, all that sort of thing. But it's worth it. Not a bad drive over there. We'll find you a way over there. See me, I'll give you the website. If you need to get a room, and I'll tell you where to get the rooms, because they're going fast over there, because this is the last one, guys, ever. So this is the last one, the 76th one. And please, I'd like to have a good showing from St. Philip. Thank you. Hey, don't let priests come.
I went for many, many years until I did become a priest. But it was just so enjoyable. The speakers were always first class. In fact, one of our speakers this year is going to be the priest who founded the Thistle and Bee ministry. So that would be worth the price of admission there. But all of those guys, just hearing their voices singing, it really is just angelic. It's very, very moving. Please do consider to attend that layman's conference. I don't know if it's going to be the very last one, but it's the last one there at
center.
Like Father Terry said, you hear these guys sing, and it's like a gathering of angels. So it's very moving.
The only time in their lives where they're going to sound like angels. I'm teasing. All right. Are there any other announcements that we might have? Do we have any birthday celebrations today? Oh, good. I heard a couple of others. Birthday celebrations. Frank?
Saturday.
And Pam? Oh, good. And Paula? All right, young men and women. Sora. Let's pray. Oh God, our times are always in your hands. Look with favor, we pray, on these your servants as they begin another year. Grant that they may continue to grow in your wisdom and grace, and strengthen their trust in your goodness all the days of their life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I bless you with this holy oil. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. I bless you with this holy oil. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
I bless you with this holy oil. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Happy birthday, you all.
Thank you.
Glad you're spending it with us. How about anniversaries? Do we have any anniversary celebrations today? Remember the words of our Lord Jesus, it is more blessed to give and to give of ourselves than to receive.
Thank you.
be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God, who by water and the Holy Spirit has made us a new people in Jesus Christ our Lord, to show forth thy glory in all the world. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and singing. Supper, he took a cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints, including Martha and Mary, into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask of your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
O Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy upon us.
O Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
Have mercy upon us.
O Lamb of God, take away the sins of the world.
Grant us thy peace.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith. With thanksgiving.
those that could not be here today, and for all of those that we have prayed for, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, keep them into everlasting life. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now may the blessings of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you for the rest of this Sabbath day, throughout your upcoming week, during our great Pentecost season, and forevermore.